So it's an honor, certainly, to be here speaking to a large audience. My classes used to be much smaller, although some of the discrete math courses were pretty large. So what I want to talk about today is, in the 10 minutes odd that I have, I'll actually rush through slides and try to actually show you some software as if time permits. So we're a software company. We're small. We started out of Ann Arbor. Now our software gets used all over North America, some parts of South America, Europe, Asia, and so on. We primarily work with the automotive industry because we started in Ann Arbor, but we also work in the healthcare space. And while there are a number of wonderful and increasingly powerful software, data science software products out there, one of the things that is often missed is everything starts and ends with us, the humans. Okay, so I'm going to try to point out certain aspects, some of which were touched on the previous talks, that the information that has to be used by us humans is also often generated starting from the humans. And some of the lowly data entry aspects are actually pretty important. So this is a slide that another one of the faculty from University of Michigan, who now heads the NSF Engineering Directorate, Professor Pramod Khargonkar, mentioned that he considers data sciences as going from data to information to knowledge. I'm sure all of these are loaded terms. He happens to be an advisor to us. We can get into discussions offline about what some of those things mean in our context. What we try to do is take raw data and convert it into what we might call actionable information, doing something with it. Okay? So what you're seeing above is what the raw data often looks like. This is opened in an Excel format, and this is a screenshot of some of our analytical software. Now, this is something from Professor Jagadish. You can see how this talk is going to go. Just pick slides from different people and put it up. So Professor Jagadish, he came and gave a talk, a very nice talk at our event a couple of years back. And the important part that he had mentioned is it's not just the analytics, it's not just the data sciences, the end product of. What you've got to look at is the extract, transform, it's called ETL, extract, transform, load, which is getting the data into a format where you can do all these wonderful things. It takes about 90 to 99% of the effort in data sciences to get things to a format where you can start doing something. That end result, which is what many of us over here are involved with, is only a relatively small part. There's a lot of work that goes in to make that happen. And it's in that light that I'll describe a few things. So in terms of data entry, this is a typical repair record in automotive repair. So when we take our cars in for repair, the technician writes up things. This is how they write it up. Take a look. It's supposed to be English, and they are in a hurry to get things done. Okay? Even though this it looks messy, it's got jargon, it's got words running into each other, split up, no syntax, grammar, punctuation, and so forth, it's actually the gold standard. It's actually the most important input data to subsequent data analysis and subsequent data sciences. So what one has to do is take this and then convert it into something like this, essentially extract out relevant information from it. After that, you can go about doing a number of different things like analytics and so forth. What I'm showing you and what I'll hopefully get to show you in the next 5 minutes is, in fact, software that is used in multiple different places. It's not research. It's actually in commercial use. The market sizes for this lowly data entry process it happens to be very big. These are actual direct market sizes for that are open to groups like ours. In healthcare, of course, which many of you are represented in this room, it's 10 times that of automotive, as most of us know. Okay, and there are other data-driven technologies. There is an aspect after you can pull the detailed information out of, say, the text in such data, you can do various kinds of things, which is closer to what many of us here are working on, which is the machine learning aspects. So this is a screenshot. I'm going to try and show you this thing running, where you describe the symptoms for your vehicle, and boom, you get a differential diagnosis of what the problem is, how to fix it, and so forth. This, by the way, is going to be not necessarily from our company, but it's going to be commonplace in about 2 to 3 years. Okay, we've been in interactions with various automotive companies. I don't know about the healthcare side, whether that will happen. Our technology is easy to add on to existing infrastructure. I'm going to skip across this. We've got an add-on for Excel. I'm going to jump to actually showing you some software. So this is, I'll load some data here. This is a technician comment, a customer comment. The technician performed some AC pressurized test, et cetera, et cetera. When I code it, it generates the results at the bottom. On the right side is the debug output. So this is, you know, just to show you it's real. Load one more, and just to illustrate the point. And you know, there are about 600 million records generated in North America for repairs in the automotive field. Worldwide, it's much more. And our software happens to work, the technique happens to work in you know, essentially world languages. So code this, it generates these results. So just to give you a sense, all of the results, all of the data that say General Motors produces worldwide in a day could run through this laptop in about half hour or so. And it's completely parallelizable. I'll skip across our, this is our analytics dashboards and whatnot. I'll skip across that. What I'll show you is this, which is more interesting. This is essentially a front end to a diagnostics system. At the back end, there is data from which information has been extracted, in particular from the text, okay? It's all synthetic data, just to make sure that you're, you know, nobody over here gets worried. I'll use Ford is local here. I'll use a example from Ford. By the way, again, this is synthetic data, so don't go rushing off and trying to repair your F-150 if you see something like this there. So I'm putting check engine light, and I'm using spelling I used to use in, nursery. But given that our technology understands this, it'll make sense of it, or it should. So when I submit just this much, based on the data available, it tells you that it's probably an electronic fuel injection problem, and then it gives you certain directed diagnostics, meaning it lets you ask certain questions. If it is a model year 2001, it changes the distribution, okay? And it tells you what the likely repairs are, what the co-occurring repairs what co-occurring problems might be, and so on. And all this happens very quickly. It's essentially running, it's a different kind of machine learning, if you will. It's not trying to create a model, because typically building complex models is very difficult. We don't want to try to do the research aspects in it. We try to do the actual, get this out to people. So this is available, of course, on handheld devices, and it's possibly going to make its way into the dashboards of vehicles and so on and so forth. So I'm going to skip across also the stuff. Basically, you can go from the raw data through our ETL piece, which I quickly showed you, and then go on to do a number of different things. This was the quick demos. The experience that we have indicates that the inputs are extremely important to get the subsequent analysis and machine learning and statistical stuff to work well. So the input data is important. Sensor data tends to be still unreliable. You've got to do quite a bit of summarization, et cetera, to handle that information. But at the end of the day, data sciences and technology is a human endeavor. It's by the people, for the people. So taking that into account, keeping that in mind, makes a big difference as to what and how one should go about building such products and make it useful for all of us. And with that, I'll end it. Thank you.
It started for us as hiring a diverse faculty. making a commitment to that. And, you know, we did that. And, you know, from the, you know, all male kind of nerd coders that we were.